nonprofit's going to let us do that? Not a chance. So, you know, you've got the two curves going in opposite directions. So we have to find ways to be more efficient and more effective with how we clean water. And we have a lot of seasonal residents who just use surface water. And they use the filtration systems and they use the UV systems. What's the matter with the UV system? Anybody know what the biggest problem with the UV system is? You know what turbidity is?
It doesn't work with high turbidity.
Yeah. High turbidity is cloudiness in the water. So bacteria can hide behind that turbidity in the water and they don't get killed off. So that winds up coming right through your system, right through your tap, right into your glass. Thank you very much. We're also in an area where there's a lot of heavy agriculture. So in Oakwood, when we moved in, we had a community water system, which was great. Basically, it was four tanks in a row. And we had one of the local guys that used to look after the chlorine in it. Depended on whether or not he was having a good day or a bad day, whether or not he felt like coming in on Sunday night or not. Because there's days that the chlorine would be way up here, and other days it would smell like a swamp. So we took the system out, and we're now hooked up to Lindsay water. Water still smells the same. Some days it smells like a swamp, other days it smells like a swimming pool. It's a lot cleaner. We know it's safer. Why did we have to take out our system? Because the nitrates in our water were consistently above 10 parts per million. When I went into the municipal office at the time, because we were a two-tier system back then, and said, I'd like to see the recordings for the water. Oh, you can't see that. Yeah, I can. Well, no, you can't. Well, according to the Ontario Drinking Water Objectives, I can. Oh, no, that's you'd have to get an FOI. What? Well, the reason was, we had an infant. And at 10 parts per million, that can cause blue baby syndrome. So I always found it kind of interesting that I am a bureaucrat now, that they were trying to keep that information from me. So my years as community advocacy really came to the forefront because I was such a royal pain in the ass about this. I actually had meetings in the community about water. Well, you had a hell of a nerve doing things like that. So for years, I was persona non grata. But now that we're doing this with water, everybody's like, yeah, this is really cool. But we're having trouble understanding it. So what we want, we've created the International Center of Excellence for Water Quality. And that's virtual at this point. Dr. Wooten has about 54 companies that he works with from around the world. And the beauty of that is, he now sits on Watertown, Provincial Watertown Program. He sits on the UN Water Commission. He's been to Israel. They're now part of the team, the international team that wants to clean up the Ganges River Basin. They've been to Mongolia. Dr. Rudin's been to China a number of times. So with an asset like that in the community, how can you not want to do this? I have a report going to council at the end of this month for the Kawartha Lakes Innovation Center. And that's built on ice water. And the premise is that we're going to look at shelter. And everything from a green roof, to a living wall, to alternative energy, to how precipitation is treated around a building. Are we going to use porous concrete so that the water can actually percolate through without running off? Are we going to separate gray water and black water systems in your home? Are we going to create gray water systems in a box so you can retrofit your house? What types of things can we look at? Because if I use the term stick frame construction, does everybody understand what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. Basically a 2x4 house and the way they're built today, when you see a subdivision going up and you see a stick frame. Well, factory built homes have been around for about 40 years. And everybody says, oh, well, you know, well, factory-built homes are going to become more the norm because stick-frame construction is very wasteful of wood, of drywall, of water, all of those components that go into building those subdivisions that you see popping around, up around the GTA now. So we are going to shift, and I want to be at the forefront of that. So I want to be tackling the knowledge economy, which is where Canada has to go, because we have to start exporting things like knowledge. We're not going to export widgets. We can't afford to build widgets anymore here. But knowledge, we're at the forefront of that in a lot of different areas. And water is one of those areas that Canadians should not be taking for granted, should be pursuing. And here's an opportunity for us with Trent University, Fleming College, and the 250 lakes and rivers that we have in our municipality to be at the forefront of that. And that's where we want to be for all of those reasons. Because for the most part, colleges have always been a practical applications learning environment. And that's great up to a point, but how do you turn that into knowledge that you can export? So that when we talk to other countries, we can say, well, we're going to send you expertise, and that's going to be in the form of our graduates. That's not going to be a DVD, it's not going to be a book, it's going to be our graduates that go over there and they spend time doing that in those countries. And that's the kind of thing that I think EcoLogos and what we're trying to do with Ice Water and the Porth Lakes Innovation Center, that's the economy of tomorrow. We just have to get there. And I'll tell you, north of 7, sometimes that's a tough sell. Because we have lots of water around us and we just don't see the need, right? But last summer was really hot and we had 3 instances of blue-green algae. Well, that's 3 too many for us. So when our tourism operators start phoning up and saying, what are you going to do about this? We had better have been on this 10 years ago, not just getting into the game now. And that's the biggest problem we have, is we're just getting into the game now. My first degree was resources management. And I spent a lot of time in my 4 years looking at alternatives to septic systems in cottage country. Now, why would a teenager want to do that? Well, if you know what a class 1 septic system is, it's one hole and 1 5-gallon bucket, and guess who had to empty that thing? So I spent a lot of time trying to figure out what's the alternative. Well, everybody knows what a septic system is, right? And you know how that works?
Sure.
Sure? Has that changed much in 2,000 years?
No.
A little bit.
Little bit. And you know what that little bit is? We now put 10 times as much water through it on a day than we used to. And it wasn't designed for that. So when you look at the different types of septic systems that are out there now, and you look at the water loop biofilter, and you look at the EcoFlow, it's all great stuff, except you still need that filter medium, and the filter medium used to be soil. Well, in cottage country, it's shitty soil for that, no pun intended, because it's too fine, it doesn't adsorb any of the nutrient, it just flows through. It
goes in the
There's
lake.
There's very little overburden on the bedrock. So when the effluent gets to the bedrock, where does it go?
It
goes right into the lake. And that's assuming that you've got a septic tank with a tile field, and not just a 50-gallon drum that you bang the end of.
It's just lucky that those people aren't there all year round.
Well, but they are now. That's just it.
That's the problem.
They are now. They're starting to convert those family cottages. And we've been on Redstone Lake since 1946. So I've seen the water quality go an environment that would support freshwater clams to an environment now that we have very few diving beetles. We have no crustaceans. We used to have some. We have none. You might hear the odd bullfrog, but not anymore. So the water quality has changed dramatically. When I was the president of the Federation of Ontario Cottagers Associations, one of the things I wanted our group to look at was the qualitative aspects of the change in water quality by sending out a questionnaire to cottagers that had been around for 40 years mm-hmm. and ask them how the water had changed. Mm-hmm. Not very scientific, but the anecdotal evidence is amazing when you actually sit down and read it. So Folk put together a book called Take the Plunge. And Take the Plunge was, when did I join Folk? In 1998, and we were talking about putting it together then. I think we finally published it in 2004, 2005, and it was just updated in 2009. There's another one called Living by the Water. The Rideau Canal put that one out. There's a group around there. Kawartha the Lakes has all of these different, we're just putting together our Integrated Community Sustainability Plan, ICSP, because we want to be this sustainable community. And we've worked for years at doing this, but now we're starting to formalize it, and we're starting to do things with it, which is why it's so nice to have EcoLogos say, we want to partner with you in Fleming College, mm-hmm. because it gives us that much more reach outside of our community. Out. And economic development's all about reach outside the home community. So, anyhow, that's it. I could go on for hours. I was told 15 minutes, and I'm well over that. So.